It's my go-to story about the mortifying reality of being a teenager who is naive about sex. So I tell it right then and there. And now here. I was 16 years old, dressed pretty and sitting in the classroom at a university close to where I lived. The university hosted a distinguished lecturer series and brought in guest lecturers to speak to the kids in the honors and gifted programs from high schools across or around the county. I was a good girl, and every 2 months or so I'd be excused from class to attend the events for scholastically gifted students. I didn't think much about the label. My school didn't care much for scholastics. It was more important to the principal that I was a cheerleader. We didn't have official college prep courses or a National Honor Society. No one had ever heard of our camp. But that doesn't really matter. What matters is this. I was 16, and I was extremely shy in situations that existed outside my school district. Yet somehow, I kept getting sent to represent that school. I was okay being seen, but rarely did I want to be heard. I was sitting in that classroom to listen to a drama teacher talk to us about Shakespeare. I'd never read Shakespeare, but I was a good girl. I'd give it a go. I sat quietly in the second row of seats and listened, with my hands folded in my lap. I don't remember much about the lecture content, but I have a vague recollection of the man. He was older, thin, and slouching, but still full of energy and ready to sprint the length of the blackboard. Strands of long gray hair followed his ears as he went back and forth across the front of the class. The top of his head reflected light from the fluorescent bulbs above us. He seemed to speak gibberish, but spoke clearly when he stopped in front of me, pointed to my face, and said, "What do you think the sex was like between our man and Lady Macbeth?" I was caught off guard. Although even on guard, I would have had a good answer. So I said, "Slow?" Laughter erupted, and I grew red in the face. Now, I've told this story a lot, for a lot of years. And since the moment I recognized it, the humiliating and hilarious portrait it was, and is. For 15 years, I've told the story as an example of how embarrassing it was to be so naive about sex at that age. And everyone who has heard the story has scoffed at my ignorance. Or laughed at it. But then, right as I finished the story, this time, for this particular audience, meaning my camp instructors, I could feel something shift in my mind. And just as the epiphany was coming to me, my 22-year-old teaching assistant says, "What a perv." And he's right. Here I am, talking about how embarrassing it was to be 16 and say something so stupid about sex. But who points to a 16-year-old girl and asks what it must be like in the bedroom of an old king and his queen? It took 20 years, and how many episodes of Law & Order SVU, for me to figure that out. I'm even a feminist, and I couldn't even articulate it when I did figure it out. Now I have a whole other thing to be embarrassed about, that I thought I was the one who should be embarrassed by that story. The lecture wasn't so distinguished, and I'm certainly not so gifted. And I was also 16 and not 12, but that was 20 years ago. Isn't 16 the new 12, the way 20 is the new 30, something like that. But the truth revealed itself. Some way, somehow, the truth will always surface. For too many years, I chose to believe in the truth of my humiliation. Now, I believe in the embarrassment I feel for that old man, the one who singled out the girl, the one who knew he was speaking to a room full of minors and decided to shout about sex. He might have thought he was speaking our language, but why would that be our language that age? It wasn't my language at that age, and that's a truth that took 20 years for me to know. It's a short piece called "We're Not Dumb People." And that's probably not how the title comes off on paper, but that's how I hear it in my head. I was fresh out of graduate school and 3,000 miles away from home when Rusty, the family dog, passed away. My father called to tell me the news. I was driving. I pulled over on a side street and stopped. I called a friend for consolation as she asked, "Will your parents get another dog?" Her question made me furious. "No! No, they won't get another dog," I said. "We're not dog people. We don't just go get another dog. We're Rusty people, and he's gone now." I practically spit the words through the phone. The idea of another dog was completely ridiculous. We couldn't love another animal as much. Rusty showed up as a puppy on our doorstep when I was a freshman in high school. We lived on a very busy street, and it was a shock to hear his whimper from the far end of the porch while we unlocked the door. We had no idea how he got there. We resisted. The puppy stayed on the porch while we figured out what to do. Within a week, he was in the house. He didn't have a name for a month. He responded to whatever we called him. I called him Baby, my little brother called him Puppy, my father called him Shithead. In that span of 30 short days, he became rough. rusty because he was, well, a rusty color. Original, right? His rust-colored hair covered our couch, our blankets, our beds. He took over our furniture with a quiet control. He knew he'd taken over more than just objects in the house. We couldn't get enough of him. None of my friends had dogs, so they didn't understand when I preferred to stay at home on Friday nights, just to hang with Rusty. We tried taking him on short walks, but it was clear that he wasn't thrilled about being attached to a leash. It wasn't he couldn't go off after every, it meant he couldn't go off after every dog we passed. Our solution at the time was simply to stop walking him and instead play with him in the fence backyard. We didn't socialize with other dogs, and he certainly didn't mind. He liked having us all to himself. He liked being the only dog around. There was a dog less than a block away. When Rusty was outside, the dog would bark, and Rusty would bark back, sometimes with his teeth bared. Rusty didn't like other dogs, so we didn't like other dogs. We decided then that Rusty wasn't a dog's dog. We didn't know a lot of other people with dogs, so it didn't matter much. He stayed in the house or the yard, and the entire family was just fine. He was happy to wedge himself between one of us and the arm of the recliner. He didn't care to do dog things. He didn't play chase or catch. He didn't like rawhide shoes because he preferred jelly beans. He didn't beg to go on walks. He just wanted to curl up beside us or sleep up against us. And that's what we wanted him to do, too. His devotion made a profound impression on us. When my friend asked if we'd get another dog, I couldn't conjure up any way that any one of us would feel comfortable with another dog. I couldn't have my own dog when I was in college or graduate school because I couldn't bring it around for the holidays. That was my time with Rusty, and he certainly wasn't going to share it. Less than a year after his death, I decided to reduce the 3,000 miles between me and home. The more I planned and organized my move, the more I realized that a big piece of what meant home to me would be missing. The entire time I lived on my own, I felt a big void. Something was off. I couldn't define it. A few months before I moved, I started volunteering at an animal shelter around the corner from where I worked. I'd walk dogs and be around dogs, and I found myself looking online for adoptable dogs near my hometown. I told my friends I'd be back and have a dog before my job started. My parents were skeptical. I moved, and a week later, I found Brody. On a Saturday evening, a friend and I were out running a quick errand and suddenly decided to drive out to the pound. It was past 6 p.m., and we knew they'd be closed, but we went anyway. We parked the car near the entrance and walked up to the door. In an after-hours drop box was the scrawniest puppy I'd ever seen. He had long legs and giant black ears and a tail that looked like it had been dipped in black paint. He was rust-colored. We pulled him out of the drop box and put him on the ground. He looked up at me, and I looked down at him and said, "Well, I guess you're it." And so it began like a hurricane. Brody was 7 pounds for me, and my entire family fell in love fast. That love made us miss Rusty, yes, but everyone quickly realized that something big had been missing in our lives. There was a dog-sized hole. Soon after I found Brody, my parents rescued a German Shepherd puppy. Then my brother picked up a Yorkie. Then I picked up another. Then my brother picked up. Then my parents. There are now 6 dogs in the family. My 2, my parents 2, and my brother's 2. When we get together at the holidays, it looks like a party at the pound. We make sure that all the dogs were socialized early so there wouldn't be much or so much territorial misbehavior. They get along fine. We laugh sometimes about what Rusty would think of all these dogs in his house, on his furniture, sleeping in his beds. It hasn't escaped us that we've gathered 6 dogs to fill the space left by one Rusty. We were Rusty people, no doubt, but Rusty was what he was, which was a dog. And I guess that made us all